Hello everyone, what's up? I am Shion from the smartgrid.us. This is an ongoing series about GridLab-T tutorial bootcamp. In this tutorial, we are going to see how to use players in GridLab-T. So players is what we use in GridLab-T to modify parameters inside a model. So it is a very useful tool, and let's see how that works. You have observed that in GridLab-T in the previous lecture that we have recorders in which we record different parameters inside the model while running simulations, while players is something that we can use in GridLab-T to modify objects inside the simulation model. So if you have any object in a GridLab-T model, we can modify using players. So for players, we definitely need the tape module that we discussed before, and this tape module can be included as is or with additional parameters like the GNU plot path or the flush interval to clear out the memory. Now, this tape module is absolutely mandatory if we have to use the GridLab-T player. So the tape module has the player, it has shapers, and it has also the recorders which we discussed in the previous lesson. In this lesson, we'll focus on players. It has the ability to interact with MySQL that we will see in a little while. Now we will see how players and the model essentially interacts with one another to create the recorders or the simulation, how values change within the recorders. So the player interacts with the distribution system model, and then this interacts with recorder. The player can be the solar insulation, it can be a load profile, and it is written into a player file, which can be just like thermostat settings. All these things can be part of the player file, and then they get mapped into the distribution system model where there are different objects within the GLM file, and this player interacts with these model at every time step of the simulation. And at every time step, if you configure the recorder that way, it gets written out to the recorder. And you can plot histograms and other forms of charts and everything that you want using this. The player is part of the GLM file, and so there can be a start-stop, you can run player in a loop. If you want to have the power flow, it's mandatory, and the tape module is absolutely a must if you are using the player in a GridLab-T model. The player can be put inside an object like a house or a node or any of this. So objects can be nested. It is very important to remember this in GridLab-T or any other object-oriented programming. Objects can be nested, both recorders and the players, both can be nested, and they can be placed inside the house object, and we can essentially have the recorders after that. We can also have the players outside of them, but that's another way. So this is essentially how an object player typically looks, whether it's inside. Let's go back to that file once more. Yeah. So this is how a player usually looks like, and it has a name, because a name is very important. And this name of this player, that is how it interacts with other objects inside the GridLab-T model. So if I have a house and I have a player, the only way that the house and this player can interact with one another is via the name. And that is how these things are referenced with one another. However, if they are nested, then the name of the player or the name of the house is not very important in the context. So if I have a house and I have placed the player object inside the house, then the name is not required, while it will be implied that the player is acting on the house itself. It can be a CSV file, text file, or a .player file. You can run the same file 1,000 times, any number of times by using the loop command. So that is how a player looks like. This is how a player file looks like, which I again said it can be a CSV, a text file, anything you want. The first thing it needs to be is a time, and you have to mention the time in this way, and then essentially all other things are relative to the first time you read out time. And these can be at intervals of hours, it can be intervals of minutes, it can be intervals of seconds, just as in this example, or days and things like that. But M, remember, M stands for minutes, though M usually means meters, but in our case it will just mean minutes. And these values that you see, it can be in form of angles if you're modifying voltages, like in polar form, and it can also be integers, floats, or any other type that is supported by C++ or GridLabD. The first and the last usually matches in a player file, and though if you run it at zero times, the loop is zero. But if you want the same player file to act on the object n number of times, you have to give an integral value or an integer value at the end of the, so like 10. You just run it 10 times and then the same player file will be played 10 times on the object in a loop. So that's about player files. So let's go ahead and start doing some example in the hands-on part of this code. Let's go ahead to our computer. So this is my screen, and let me just make it large, just a little bit large so that you can see it clearly. Let me create two files. One will be the GLM file, the GridLabD model. Start by writing out the clock, the time zone. It must go first, I insist. The time zone must go first. Since I'm based off Pullman, Washington, I'll just put it Pacific time. We need a start time, definitely. 2017, 07, 10. Let's start at midnight. It's kind of a convention, but you can start anytime. We can put a stop time. That would just mean that the simulation will stop at this time. But if you're using, say, players, I must insist that you can avoid the stop time and just run the simulation in time of loop. I'll come back to that later. Since we're using a house, we need the residential module. We'll use players, so this is a must, the tape module, and then let's start our house. The house will be, we need a name for the house, maybe. So if I don't know what exactly goes inside the house, let's go and find help from the GridLabD console, like we learned in one of our previous lessons. So our lesson will look like this. Our example, go to the GridLabD console, let's type GridLabD. GridLabD dash it's dash dash mod help. Oh, sorry, dash dash mod help. Let's do an example actually. So I need to mention the dash dash example residential house, and now we can find out that whatever parameters the house takes in, it was already part given out as an example. So if you want to build out our house, we can essentially take just one or two of them or go ahead and populate all of them. Then we'll have the detail module of a house, the load, the energy, the peak demand of the house, the heat gain, the cumulative heat gain, power factor, cooling set points, weather, floor area, wall area, the ceiling height, all kinds of architecture parameters we can use to model houses using the residential module. So we now had a good example. Let's try and build out our house a little bit. So just we'll try to see how it interacts with energy. So let's model a simple house with HVAC so that we can play around with its HVAC settings. Model a simple house with HVAC. Now let's say the heating set point, and let's give it a heating set point of 40 degrees Fahrenheit. That is usually the default, but you can be explicit with the units. The cooling set point is going to be, say, 90 Fahrenheit. So if the house temperature is above 90, we're going to start cooling the house. And let's Now let's go about the details of our players, how we implement or place the players. First approach, we can place the player in a nested fashion, and we place the player inside the house. In this case, it is important to remember that we do not have to give the player name. The approach two would be referencing the player by placing it outside of the house. So there is no algorithmic advantage in either of those things as far as I know, but it's up to the user convenience. So let's start with approach one first, and I'll just keep the approach two for later. And in approach one, I just start writing out the player like so, object player, and let's do this, object player. And I have to give the property that I want to mess around with, say the cooling set point of the house. This, you have to be very careful because it needs to match with the house property as is, verbatim. And we want to read these from a CSV file where we have set point data. So let's say we have a CSV file like house.heat, and we want to run this player file, say 10 times. So when we mention this, we can get rid of the stop time because we know that this is gonna be just run 10 times. So we can either give a stop time when the loop will stop or loop it, or we can have both. And I guess the stop time has a higher precedence. Even if you loop it 10 times, but the simulation goes more than the stop time, it just stops. So just get rid of stop, loop it 10 times and see how it goes. As of now, we do not have a house heat.csv. Let's go ahead and create one. Go to Excel and just type househeat.csv. Okay, so now when we have that, we will just type out. So remember, the first thing has to be the time, and Excel will try to get its default, but we need to put this one. So copy this and let's put it in Excel. And paste it. Oh, so Excel tries to modify it, giving its tone, but you know, GridLab cannot process that. So we will essentially just have to format this as a text file so that Excel doesn't do its own smartness. Up now, it's working, not working out. We'll just paste it again now. Okay, now we have it in a format that GridLab likes. So this is where the simulation starts, and we can give the initial set point, say a random of 75 degrees Fahrenheit, and all these other timestamps are going to be relative. So we can increase it by intervals of say 1 hour, 1h. So plus 1h, and after 1 hour, you just increase it a little bit, decrease it, do whatever you want. So I'm just essentially typing out random stuff to see you, help you see what, how to create a player file. So I'm saving it in househeat.csv, giving random values for, say, 4 hours of simulation. And we'll do it 10 times because the loop value is 10. So, yeah, I think that's good enough for a demonstration. These are relative values, remember that, and all these are formatted as text. Okay, so now when we have that, we can try running our model. Just give me a bit of time while I see how to run the model. We'll go to the GridLabD console and we're gonna clear out, maybe. Yes, let's clear out. And then we go to the exact place where we have our file. Let me see where I kept this. Okay, GridLabD models it is. Let's go there and let me type out the path. And there it is. So we go to this VCD into change directory, and now we can see all the files that we have. So these are files from some of our previous tutorials. So we can go to the folder player demo where we are saving our files, and now let's see what we have inside here. So we have a househeat.csv that we built using Excel and a glm file where we had our model. So to run the model, GridLabD player example.glm. Now we do not see anything happen because the player did stuff, but there was no recorder to record what the player did. So at this point, what we have to do is go ahead and create recorders so we can observe what the player file did. So see, So there you see, we have to get rid of this. This is formatted as UTF-CSV, so I recommend not saving as UTF-CSV. We'll fix that a little later. But anyways, let's try out a recorder. Before recording that, let's move this player outside of the house and create it using approach 2, and we have to reference it using the name. All right. And okay, we have to give this player a parent and we reference it to the house. So how do you reference it? The house doesn't have a name yet. So I think we have to give the house a name. Name, and I'll give it university housing. And that's where my house is. So I'll give it house name, and we have to be very specific while we do the reference, and careful that the name absolutely matches up. It is guest sensitive, you have to remember that. And then, okay, now let's create our recorder. Right, so let's create a recorder and record what the player is doing. We could not observe that when we ran the simulation. So object recorder, you recall from the last lesson, and then we are going to do is we have to give a file where we want to save our values. So I'll give it a file, recorded properties dot txt semicolon. And remember, the colon at the end of the object nested is very important as well. Now, what property you want to record? We are messing with the cooling set point, so I guess that is what our object of interest is, our property of interest. It's so, and it has to match with the exact property in the house module also. So we will try to record that value. So cooling set point. And that's about it. So once we have that, I guess we can start recording what this player is doing. Okay. Now we go to our console and try to run this file again. So gridlabd player example.glm. And we see that there is no triplex meter, but that, let's ignore that warning. And now we see that the recorded properties.txt, that is what the recorder has recorded from the CSV player file, and see how this housey.csv, so this was our player file, like four lines of changes on the object house, and we can see what this recorded text looks like. So cat recorded text, and there you go. So 10 times these three lines of the after the initial set point, this three has been repeated 10 times at 1 hour intervals, 8, 9, 10, at 1 hour intervals, and we see that the object has been modified all those times. So that is how we see how the player interacted with the object house, and it did for 10 times, because the loop was 10 times and there was no stop time given to it. So that's very interesting. Now there are other things we can do with player. So if we want more granular data, we can use a flag called delta mode for sub-second simulation, and you observe the minus one thing in the previous, so that can also help you simulate transform. Now, player transforms. Now, let's take a moment to see how this thing works. So if you have one player, it can have different roles on different objects. Like a man has different roles, but as many different roles based on different relationships, whether it's the wife, with the daughter, a mother, or the boss. So a player can also have different relationships with different objects. Now, when you have to do that, so the player, every property can be modified using the syntax, the source, what it originally has, then we can multiply it with an a scalar value and offset it. Remember that this syntax is going to be very, very important. We cannot change the syntax while doing player transforms. So scalar and offset. So you have to internalize this while you're trying to build player transforms. Now, once we have these player transforms, it becomes a very powerful tool because we can then change different objects using the same player that we constructed, and then we have the ability to have different manipulations for different objects. How do you implement that? The first thing that you have to do at the beginning of the program is you have to declare a class player and then assign a value to it. So this class player needs to be done only once at the top of your GLM file. And then you can call it value or anything you want, essentially, that you want to mess around with. Then you write your player once, and then you see that for each of the houses that we have, we can go ahead and start modifying those. Now let's go back to a computer and let's start by writing the class player. We have to do it once, remember that. And we'll give it a double and value. And we can access all player properties by dot value in the future interactions with the house. So we have a value. And now let's create another house. We want to have at least two objects that we want to interact with. So I have already a house, now I'll build my office. So my WSU office, and I'll have the same set of parameters or properties, our heating set point. I'll give it 40 degrees Fahrenheit, because 40 is kind of cold. And cooling set point in the office might be a little lower, just to see how it works, 80 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, I have two objects that I will want my player to clearly interact with. So I'll take this player and put it up front. Let me just take it up front, ahead of the objects, just for the sake of clarity. And I'll have two individual recorders. I'll give it office recorded properties for the office so that I can observe the values. Now, let's take my recorder a little ahead. So let's place the recorder here, and it's essentially like creating an instance of the player class that we just modified upstairs. So we will create a player object right around here, and give it a name, anything like cooling player. And we have to read it off the cooling player. I'm just messing it up. The player name should not have a CSV. So the file name should have a CSV out of which we want to read it. So this can be another cooling player file that we have, and then we have to make sure that it loops a certain number of times because we have not the stop time yet. So we'll get rid of this player file. And we will just use the cooling player. So instead of having individual set points, what we will do is we'll use a player transform this time and say out of this cooling player, what we will have to do is like for my university housing, I'll just do a cooling set point. I'll do the cooling player, the player, and just use the value that I just built in the class and then modify it by multiplying it with a scalar and then offsetting it by any random integer. Similarly, I can go ahead and do it for my office. Cooling set point, cooling player dot value star 1.5 and 15. So now I have a player transform. So one player, but I have two different relationships based on the house and the office. So this is how the player transform is working. Let's see how that plays out. So now GridLab D, let's say it's player example.glm. Oops, oh yeah, so clueling player.csv doesn't exist yet. But remember, we already have some other file that we created for the previous segment. I think it was called heat.hsv. So let's replace this one. Yes, it was called househeat.csv. And now let's see how this works out, because we're sure that this file definitely exists. So we will go and try to run the simulations right now on this one. Okay, so GridLabD, player.example. Okay, just warnings, no errors. So now we will see that what are the files. Now you see that we have created the office recorded properties and the recorded properties.txt. Wow, that is so cool. Now it's in the house, we see that this has been modified 3 times according to that random number. And let's see the office recorded properties, and it has been modified in a very different way. So in this lesson, what we learned is how to modify player files, how to modify objects inside player files. But in the next lecture, we'll see how to control by external programs like MATLAB. In the next lesson, what we are trying to do, we'll try to use these player files and make the GridLabD models interact with external programs like MATLAB or Python or anything else. So I hope to see you in lesson number 7, where we deal with this. So, all right, see you next time. Thank you for listening.